Industrial fans are extra large to provide air circulation in a large factory or warehouse. They whip up a breeze to keep workers cool. And in the process, they clear the air of dust and other harmful particles. Almost 3 feet in diameter and a body tough enough to survive a run-in with a forklift, this is no ordinary fan. It's an industrial fan. They're designed to circulate air in large spaces like warehouses and factories. Production starts with the motor. A worker slides the fan's aluminum hub onto it. Then he inserts wing-like blades known as airfoils into notches in the hub. Using a hammer, he taps the ends to set them in the hub. He places a part known as a taper lock into a hole in the center. The taper lock will fasten the motor shaft to the hub. He screws the lip of the lock to the hub. He confirms that each screw has been set to the desired torque. Next, he installs a glass-reinforced plastic cone on the hub. This one secures the ends of the blades in the hub. He snaps a cap onto the center of the nose cone. Now, he transfers the motor and hub assembly to a mount that's in a heavy-duty plastic ring. He adds an upper mount and screws it to the lower one. This completely encases the motor and hub assembly. He trims the outer ring of the fan with rubber molding. The rubber will reduce vibration noise. He lowers a steel yoke onto the plastic surround and attaches it with a screw. He wires a speed control mechanism to the fan motor and fastens it to the outside of the plastic surround. He installs a plate with a control knob on the front of the speed control mechanism. He screws on two metal screens to the fan's yoke. This forms a safety cage around the fan. He plugs the fan into a power source and turns it on to test its function. Satisfied that it's in good working order, he tightens the screens to the yoke. A two-person crew bolts a wheeled pedestal to the stem of the fan. They set the 108-pound fan upright. It's now ready to circulate. Designed to move large volumes of air, this industrial fan generates a considerable breeze inside a factory. To make an industrial ceiling fan, they use long aluminum airfoils. Their wing-like profile will generate lift to produce more air. A punch cuts holes to assemble them to a hub. A worker then attaches the main fan assembly to the end of a long post in order to facilitate the installation of the long airfoils. He activates a lift that raises the hub assembly, then slides the airfoils onto spars that protrude from the hub. This ceiling fan has 10 airfoils. He reinforces the installation with boomerang-shaped metal retainers. High-strength bolts secure the retainers and airfoils to the spars. He attaches plastic winglets to the ends of the airfoils. The winglets will direct air downward. He installs a trim ring on the hub. This completes the assembly of the industrial ceiling fan. Using a remote control, he tests its operation at multiple speed levels. From this vantage point, it seems pretty cool. A climbing wall is an artificially constructed wall with grips for hands and feet. These walls mimic the experience of outdoor rock climbing, but in a more controlled environment, allowing people of all ages and abilities the opportunity to climb. A climbing wall can have a flat surface studded with handholds that the climber grabs or steps on. Or it can be what's called rock realistic, designed to look like a natural rock wall. That type can also have handholds, or just cracks and fissures like the real thing. The factory builds the wall structure out of thick steel bars. Workers weld them into frames. Each frame will hold a panel that's one portion of the wall face. They reinforce the corners of the frame with gusset plates. Each frame is a distinct size and shape. To make the panels for a flat surface climbing wall, workers trace the frames on plywood or engineered wood particle board. After spray painting the corresponding part code, they cut out each panel to match the wall plan. Then they screw in T-nuts. These nuts have a larger than standard flange for extra strength. They screw a bolt in the middle of the T-nut to protect the threads from the cement finish they will spray onto the wood. To make a rock realistic wall, they mold cement panels to attach to the steel frames. To mix the cement, they combine ice and liquid polymer. Ice keeps the cement from overheating in the mixer. The polymer is a binding agent. It also makes the cement flexible so the wall doesn't crack or chip. While they mix the cement ingredients, they monitor the temperature with an infrared thermometer. Correct temperature is critical for the cement to properly set. They pour the cement through a sieve to filter out large pieces. Then they pump the cement into a spray gun. With slow and even strokes, they shoot the cement onto a silicone mold of a mountain face. After brushing it into the mold's nooks and crannies, they spray two more coats. This time, they simultaneously shoot a gun that chops and sprays fiberglass string to reinforce the cement. They compress the fiberglass reinforced cement with rollers to even out the thickness. Then they embed rebar loops. Rebar is a steel rod used for reinforcing cement. They embed thick steel rods 1 to 2 feet long along the perimeter. Then they let the cement set overnight. The next day, they extract the panel from the mold. A cement panel like this can weigh more than 600 pounds. They knock off jagged edges with a mallet and check for any weak areas caused by air pockets. After drilling numerous holes for the handhold T-nuts, they grind the edges smooth. They weld the wall panels to their corresponding steel frame and fill gaps between panels with cement. When they're building a flat surface wall, they spray a cement finish on the wood, then a coat of paint. Once the paint dries, they mount the handholds. They're made of molded polyurethane. Then they attach the wall panel to the steel frame with a nail gun. Flat surface walls are more versatile because they can hold far more T-nuts than rock realistic walls. The more T-nuts, the more locations for handholds. This enables a gym to create a greater range of climbing routes.